Members, this is the appointed time and we have a quorum. Welcome to today's meeting. Item 1, information paper issued since the last meeting. Members, please note that after the meeting of the 13th of March, the panel issued one information paper. Please find the details in item 1 of the agenda. Next regular meeting is scheduled for the 17th of May. We are going to discuss two items. First, evaluation on the effectiveness of time-varying tolls at the three road harbour crossings. Two, the trial implementation of diagonal crossings. Members, do you have any objection or views on these two proposed items? If not, then so be it. We will now move on to item 3, taxi fare increase applications. Let me invite the administration to come in. Members, if you want to ask questions, please press the button now. Let me invite the administration to come in. We're joined by Ms. Joyce Cock, PAS for Transport and Logistics, Ms. Angela Lee, Commissioner for Transport, Deputy Secretary, Ms. Ida Lee, Ms. Louise Fong, and Assistant Commissioner from the Transport Department, and Mr. William Wong, Chief Transport Officer. Commissioner, you will take the floor now. Thank you, Chairman, members. We'd like to invite the views of members on the proposed taxi fare application submitted by the taxi trade. The taxi trade provides personalized point-to-point transport services. They are relatively convenient, hence they come with higher fares. Now, in recent years, the taxi trade has been facing more and more pressure because of the complex operating environment. There are also calls for improvement on the quality of taxi services. Because of the misconduct of some taxi drivers, locals and tourists alike do not enjoy a very good user experience. So in handling the taxi trade's fare increase application, the government takes into account a holistic a basket of factors such as the changes in the operating costs, income of taxi drivers, and financial viability of the operation. Earlier, the urban taxis, New Territories taxis, and Lantau taxis put forward different fare increase proposals. Subsequently, a consensus was reached among them. For urban taxis, they're applying for an increase of 16.95%. And for anti-taxis, 15.37%, and Lantau taxis, 11.68%. The last fare increase took effect in July 2022. It's been about 2 years. After the fare increase in the middle of 2022, in some months, the travel pattern and the operating environment were still subject to the COVID-19 pandemic's impact, and we didn't resume normal travel with the mainland until early 2023. So engaging the operating circumstances of the taxi trade, we did not find it appropriate to compare the situation in 2023 and 2022. Instead, we should compare the situation with that in 2019. The trade comprises rentee drivers, owner drivers, as well as rental owners. For rentee drivers in 2023, the daily revenue of urban and rentee drivers increased slightly, whereas for Lantau rentee drivers, they saw a drop in their income because of fare revenue as well as the total meters traveled. As for the net income in 2019, they ranged from $19,000 to some $20,000. Comparing to the average monthly salary of the transport trade in the fourth quarter of 2023, that's $24,800, the figure was lower. As for taxi owners, the operating expenses have risen significantly from the 2019 level because of a surge in insurance premiums up by nearly 60% as well as 30% in repair and maintenance fees. These add to the operating costs and financial burden of taxi owners. In order to avoid idling of taxis, some owners could only rent out their taxis at rates lower than the 2019 level. The surging operating costs as well as a drop in rental income below the 2019 level. The average monthly net income after netting off inflation of rental owners and owner drivers in 2023 dropped by about 30-40%. So at the prevailing fare level, it would be very difficult to maintain the financial viability of the taxi operation. The taxi trade would like to apply for a fare increase to encourage more investment in taxi equipment and also increase income for rentee drivers so as to attract new blood. We understand that any fare proposal would affect the public inevitably. We'll take into account public acceptability of the proposal. At the same time, we are concerned, we heard loud and clear that there are calls in the community for increase in the quality of taxi services. We've introduced a number of measures such as introducing a taxi fleet arrangement as well as increasing the taxi seat capacity from 5 to 6 as well as introducing a taxi driver offense point system and a two-tier penalty system for certain taxi driver-related offenses. Let me report to members the progress. For the taxi fleet regime, we believe this is an important element to reforming the trade. We believe that the fleet taxis will be able to take the lead in reforming the trade and improving the ecosystem so as to enhance competitiveness and uplift the image of the trade in general. In fact, we just recently announced that starting from today, we will invite the trade to apply for taxi fleet licenses. The selection process is expected to complete in the middle of this year, and we will announce the results in due course. We also take into account the time needed to set up the taxi fleet, including the purchase of vehicles, carrying out modifications, recruiting staff and training drivers, etc. We will require the taxi fleet operators to commence operation in not more than 12 months after the grant of taxi fleet license. So the fleet should come into operation no later than the middle of 2025. As for other measures, we understand that some members of the trade had already made plans to introduce a 6-passenger-seater taxis to enhance the riding experience of passengers. On the two-tier penalty system, it has come into effect, and the taxi driver offense point system will take effect on the 22nd of September this year. These two measures will help combat the black sheep in the trade and improve the overall image and service quality of the trade. Before the commencement of the TDOP system in September this year, we are going to brief the trade on different occasions to ensure that they are familiar with the operation of the point system. When the taxi-related bills were examined by LegCo earlier, some members suggested that camera systems or cloud-based camera systems should be installed in the compartment so that in the case of disputes between taxi drivers and passengers, the footage can serve as collaborative evidence. This can enhance protection for passengers as well as safety of taxis in general. We're exploring the feasibility of this suggestion, and we plan to consult the trade within this year so as to consider how this mandatory measure should be implemented. Chairman, we'd like to seek the members' views on the fare increase proposals put forward by the trade. And as usual, we are going to do our gatekeeping and carefully consider all the criteria in approving the application. We'll also strike a balance between the operating environment of the trade as well as public acceptability. We're going to consult the TAC before putting forward the recommendation to the Seeing Council for consideration. The relevant proposal will only come into effect subject to negative vetting of LegCo. With the support of the Council, we envisage that this proposal will come into effect in the middle of this year. We welcome views and comments from members. The floor will now be open. Let me read out the names. Mr. Frankie Yik, Mr. Frankie Frankie Yik, Chan Siu Hong, Michael Look, Andrew Lam, Kitson Yang, Chan Pui Lam, Michael Tian, Chan Hock Fong, Dr. Loy Kwok, Mr. Tony Chan, Mr. Chow Siu Chung, Jovi Chan, Mr. Yim Kong, and myself. After Chan Siu Hong has spoken, I'm going to draw a line. I will give each member 4 minutes, Mr. Frankie Yik. Thank you, Chairman. The taxi trade fully understands that the public has made the demand for better services. However, there is black sheep in the trade, and this is the cause of all the allegations suffered by the trade. Has it to do with the penalties being too lenient, meted out by the court? Why doesn't the police take stringent enforcement action against the black sheep? They deserve the maximum penalty. They should be disqualified from driving at once when the case reaches the court. I don't think that the whole trade should be punished because of the black sheep. It is not right to say that we should enhance the quality of services before allowed a fare increase. Many taxi drivers work day and night in order to make ends meet and support their families. I understand their predicament. According to the government's paper, in 2023, for urban taxi drivers, they earned between $19,000 to $21,000 plus. As for the median income of the transport trade is $24,000 plus, so there is a 20% difference here. Most of these drivers in the transport trade are employees. They also enjoy other fringe benefits such as paid leave, medical benefits. So the difference is more than 20%. It is difficult to attract new blood to the taxi trade there. Therefore, we must enhance the quality of service and improve the operating environment in order to attract new blood. There is a need to increase fares, in other words. There are suggestions that any fare increase could only cause rent to go up, and it will be counterintuitive as far as rentee drivers are concerned. But in fact, after the last fare increase, renter owners saw a drastic drop in their income. As explained by the administration, this is due to a surge in insurance premiums and maintenance fees. And in fact, we should rely on the market mechanism. If there is a short of drivers in the market, then there is a problem. It is impossible to adjust the rent. And according to the previous three fare increases, we have observed a consensus. This is all due to the cooling period proposed by Mr. Wong Kok Hing, and that the cooling period would help renter owners observe whether there is an increase in the income of rentee drivers before proposing any rental increase. Now, in fact, the taxi license prices plummeted recently. We all know the reason why. I hope that the fare increase proposal can be passed so as to increase the income of taxi drivers and attract new blood to the trade. And with the taxi fleet regime commencing soon, I hope that more young people can join the trade. This, in the long run, will help improve the image of the trade. And in response, I fully agree that we should go after the black sheep of the trade. That is why, in my opening remarks, I already said that we're going to step up penalty, and the TDOP system will also come into operation in September.
Mr. Chen Xuhong, thank you, Chairman. Mr. Frankie Yik told us about the background of the issues we are facing. In the government's paper, I see that there is a lot of information covered, but I still would like to ask about some figures. It shows that in 2022, there was an 80% increase of fare increase. And now the taxi trade comes back and they propose an increase of over 10% of fare increase. In 2019 and 2023, we see a huge drop of income of owner drivers, and we see the pressure they are facing. So I understand why the trade is asking for a fare increase. The question is, what should be the magnitude of the increase? Now, as we make a judgment on the magnitude, we have to take into account the acceptability of the public as well as the financial viability of the taxi trade, including owner drivers. With a fare increase, it will impose a greater pressure on the public, and well, we saw some unhappy experience like taxi making detours. And another problem is, after paying taxi rental, rentee drivers aren't earning much. Now, with the increase of the operating costs, we see that in 2023, we saw a change of income for rental owners that reached 50%. Now, different taxi trades are proposing different levels of increase of fare price, taxi fares. Well, in 2023, we saw a drop in net income of drivers. How are you going to minimize the drop? How are we going to ensure that owner drivers can break even and that renter owners can at the same time enjoy an increase of income? That's my first question. Paragraph 7 of the paper mentions that you have some data in relation to the price of liquefied petroleum gas. And you are also conducting questionnaire surveys with taxi drivers. Mr. Chen, please allow time for the administration to respond. Yes, my question is, how credible or reliable are the results of your questionnaire surveys? Can you get accurate data so that we can make a detailed analysis on the data? Administration, for the taxi meter reading surveys, we can get accurate data from the taxi meters, and our questionnaires cover 9,000 drivers. We need information provided by the trade on, say, maintenance cost. We find it appropriate for us to continue to conduct such surveys. We will review whether there is a need to carry on with such surveys. Well, the administration didn't answer to answer my other questions. Well, there is no time. Perhaps the administration can provide supplementary information after the meeting. Mr. Michael Luke, well, taxi fare increase has always been controversial. For normal wage earners, we see an adjustment to our pay every year. Well, fees of services like taxi services see adjustment, and it's inevitable, I guess. But there are some bad apples in the trade. They refuse hire, they overcharge, for instance, and therefore there are complaints from passengers. How can we ensure a reasonable level of fare increase? I think the information provided by the government is not enough for members of the LegCo and the general public to have a fair discussion. We see an increase in inflation rate, and rental taxi trades are proposing an increase of $6 for taxi fare, for instance. However, it's hard for us to see the pros and cons of increasing taxi fare. For the three cross-harbour tunnels, we saw the time-varying tolls introduced by the government, and the government took into account the driving behaviors and patterns of drivers. And the government also took into account the affordability of drivers. Now, similarly, the government should take into account the affordability of passengers. Do you know if there is a certain period of time during the day where there are many idle taxis on the streets or on the roads? Or are there lots of taxis left idle in, say, in the car park where no drivers are driving them? I think we need this kind of information to make a consideration. Also, I proposed the compulsory installation of dash cams and camera system. We see such installation on the mainland. We have to protect passengers' privacy, and only certain designated people can have access to the information from the cloud-based system. However, we will need the government to subsidize such installation. Does the government have a timetable? Are you going to conduct consultation? Are you going to provide subsidies? When are you going to enact relevant laws? If we are able to enact a cloud-based camera system in the taxi compartments, then you will encourage more people to take taxis, and then taxi drivers will face less pressure, because they will see higher income. Administration. On the data, we are basically using the data to look at the operating environment of the taxi trade. We're comparing the situation between 2019 and 2023. And we're looking at the situation with rentee drivers, renter owners, and owner drivers. We also have to take into account other factors. For instance, taxis in our public transport system, it provides personalized services. So one of our policy objectives is that there has to be a reasonable differential of between taxi fares and those of other public transport modes. So we have to take into account all these factors when we make a decision on the taxi fare increase. On the point about the camera system, we're looking at the practice in Macau, for instance. We will look into how much the information we are going to collect through the camera system, and how much pressure is going to impose on the taxi trade if there is an operating cost incurred with the camera system. We'll talk to the trade within this year and see if there is a consensus among the trade to install such camera system. Mr. Andrew Lam. Now, on online cabs, well, there's a market for it. We have to look at the justifications for increasing taxi fares from the government's perspective or from previous experiences. I don't see how by increasing taxi fare it will enhance the service quality of taxis. My other question is, if we don't increase the taxi fares, what would be the impact on the taxi trade? Thank you, Chairman. Commissioner, on the quality of taxi service, well, of course, it is not that by increasing taxi fare, we will definitely see an enhancement of taxi service quality because we have to rely on the trade to be able to do that. Now we're introducing the taxi fleet regime. I understand that there are people in the taxi trade who are preparing to form taxi fleets. We need to ensure financial viability of the taxi trade in order to make for them to make relevant investments to enhance their service quality. We think that their financial viability is connected to their service quality. If they don't have the money to increase their service quality, of course, there will be complaints from passengers. So I'd like to thank members of this council to pass the bill. We are putting in place different measures to, for instance, combat the black sheep of the trade. We're introducing the taxi fleet regime. We hope that through these measures, we can encourage taxi drivers to form taxi fleets. And all these required deployment of resources from the trade. So we need to ensure the financial viability of the trade in order to achieve all these goals. So we have to look at it in a holistic manner. Mr. Andrew Lam, if you do not approve the taxi fare increase applications, would that pose any impacts on the forming of taxi fleets? Well, now we are seeking views from members concerning the taxi fare increase applications. From the statistics, we see that the taxi trade is facing a difficult time. For taxi drivers who are not going to join or form taxi fleets, we see that they are facing a difficult operating environment. Whether we will see insufficient taxis in the market in the future, well, this is not something that we want to see. For those who do not want to join fleets, they will continue to run on the streets and they will charge passengers based on the taxi meter readings. We don't know yet how many taxi drivers are going to join or form taxi fleets. We have to first encourage taxi drivers to form taxi fleets first. Mr. Kisan Yang, I have a reservation about the taxi fare increase proposals. There are many questions yet to be answered. Every time when the taxi trade submits taxi fare increase applications, we talk about attracting new blood to the industry. How many newcomers are joining the industry after each taxi fare increase applications approved? This is what I want to learn about first. Well, since the fare increase in July 2022, we're seeing an increase in the number of taxi drivers or their net income. Compared to 2019, we saw an increase of 12%, netting off the inflation rate of 6%. So such an increase in net income, I think, already is providing some kind of safeguards for drivers. So why are we seeing another round of taxi fare increase? Another controversy about this is that there have been lots of complaints against taxi drivers. It's been 2 years since the last round of taxi fare increase. We're still seeing taxi drivers refusing to accept a hire. We're still seeing them overcharging passengers. So how is the taxi fare increase going to improve the situation? Well, we're seeing an increase in operating costs of taxi drivers, and this is what you need to tackle. It's not that you can address the problem by simply increasing the taxi fare. We are also seeing an increase of insurance premiums. And why is that an increase of premiums? That's because there are more traffic accidents. Should we roll out a set of guidelines for taxi drivers so that we can minimize the number of traffic accidents, and then we'll see a drop of taxi insurance premiums? Also, do we have a platform for owner drivers to learn about who are the bad apples in the trade? We're seeing various types of accidents or incidents now. Owner drivers have the responsibility to keep an eye on who they are renting out their drive the taxis to. If you're able to do this, you can help increase the income of owner drivers.
Ride-hailing platforms such as Didi on the mainland, usually they only allow electric taxis to use the platform. Can we do something similar? Because we're going to phase out petrol cars sooner or later. About the drop of income for taxi owners, what about Chinese restaurants? Many of them have folded up. What about minibus drivers? Of course, they earn even less comparing to taxi drivers or owners. We need to be fair. If you're able to enhance taxi service quality, of course, the public won't mind paying more. If after the fare increase, the service remains appalling, then this will drive more users to turn to illegal online ride-hailing apps. You must know how prevalent the problem is. You need to give us this data to justify the fare increase. In fact, the fare increase application is proposed by the taxi trade, not by the administration. Anyway, Mr. Kisson Yang's comments are noted. We need to enhance the quality of the taxi trade, and the government will strive to help them cut costs and find ways to lower insurance premiums. In fact, we've been talking to the Insurance Authority and the Federation of Insurers to implement certain measures to manage risks not only for the taxi fleets in the future, but the taxis already plying the streets now, for example, by installing dash cams, whether with better risk control, the insurance premiums can be lowered. Mr. Chen Pulang, they are applying for a fare increase ranging from 11.68% to 16.95%. The inflation rate in March 2024 stood at 2.3%. So I think that this is, after all, a very demanding request. On the other hand, I don't see measures to enhance service quality. So I think, of course, there is a question mark over public acceptability of the application. Well, the taxi trade always transfers the problem to consumers when not asking for fare increase. Within the trade, there are problems relating to the service quality and poor management. And they have done nothing to control the operating costs arising from these problems. Now, you told us that the taxi fleet regime will be introduced and there will be better management. But we don't have many taxis in Hong Kong. That means 80% of taxis which are not joining the fleet will have the same management problems. They will continue to provide poor service in the market. The third question is about cloud-based dash cameras. You're going to consult the taxi trade, I understand, but Mr. Frankie Yik just reminded me that, in fact, the taxi trade attended a public hearing on one occasion, and even the trade took the initiative to suggest installing the cameras in the compartment. So instead of consulting the trade again, you should explore implementing the proposal within this year. it won't be very difficult to achieve, I suppose. So that if you install cloud-based cameras in taxi compartments, it will help improve the management of taxis as well as enhancing service quality in general. Commissioner, I note the members' comments on the proposed fare increase. The government, of course, will do its gatekeeping, will also balance different factors. The member just now mentioned the service quality of the taxi trade, and I'd like to respond to that. Of course, we understand the public grievance. We also understand that indeed some taxi drivers have misconducted themselves. Every year, through the Taxi Service Quality Council, we hold a competition. We nominate good drivers. And there is quite a large portion of drivers in the trade who are good drivers. So we must acknowledge their good work. At the same time, we need to enhance the service quality of the taxi trade, and this cannot be done singly by increasing fares. We have other measures, such as the taxi fleet regime. We also promulgate guidelines and issue circulars to remind the trade of the importance of maintaining service quality. About the cloud-based cameras, as I mentioned, we have commenced a study. In fact, the proposal entails some complex issues, because if cameras are installed, we need to consider the storage and processing of data and privacy concerns, and in the event of incidents, how data are to be retrieved and used, and the cost entailed, whether the trade would need to pay for the cost or whether there are other ways to cover the cost. Mr. Michael Tian.
Thank you, Chairman. The last taxi fare increase took place in July 2022. On average, the fares went up by 13%. Before 2022, the last fare increase was 2017. Within 5 years, that means in a five-year period, there was, on average, an annual increase of some 2%. That's on a par with the inflation rate. So for the fare increase that time, I found it reasonable. So since 2022, they've asked for an increase of 14% on average, and that's 7.3% per year. What happens if inflation rate continues to rise and insurance premiums likewise increases? On the last occasion, with an average increase of 13% for urban taxis, the fare increase was 11.5%, but ultimately, rentee drivers only saw an increase in income by 6.2%. We thought that owners would stand to benefit, but in fact, it was not the case. There was a drastic drop in owners' income. So what exactly is the problem? We have two groups of passengers. One group would always ride in taxis regardless of the fare levels. The other group would be affected by the fare increase. They would rather turn to other forms of public transport. According to the trade, the fare increase would deter some passengers, and that creates difficulties in the operating environment and drop in the driver's income, etc. Now, these are the two factors, A and B. An increase in fare income would lead to drop in patronage. But this is not only the only factor, because we also receive a lot of complaints from the public about the poor service quality. You always claim that there is the black sheep in the trade. I don't know whether it's just a small number or what. In fact, I went to a taxi stand. I wanted to take a taxi to Kowloon, and upon hearing that, the taxi driver asked me to get off and take another taxi instead. But that stand should allow taxis crossing the harbour as well. So I said that this is a case of refusal to hire, and then the taxi driver succumbed to my request and then asked me to show him directions. I don't know whether this should be called a black sheep case. So instead of increasing taxi fares, you should consider ways to lower insurance premiums. Mr. Tan, please allow time for the administration to respond to you. Right, I'll wrap up now. My take is that we should put the fare increase proposal on the back burners and work on other problems first. Well, it's been 2 years. The accumulative inflation rate is 4% and the wage increase in the same period is 6%. So it seems inevitably they should ask for an increase of 5% because at the same time the MTR fares and other public transport fares also increase. So inevitably they should ask for a fare increase. So how about 5%? We find a middle of the road solution on the condition that they enhance taxi service quality. Because if we reject the fare increase this round, they won't be able to catch up with inflation. Right, please note his comment. Yes, Mr. Chen Hongfeng. I think many members already commented on the service quality of taxis in Hong Kong. I'm looking at this paper. The paper explains the operating environment and changes in the income of drivers and owners, but the paper is silent on changes in patronage. Well, it's pointless if we allow incessant fare increases while patronage drops. Has the transport department assessed the change in patronage after each fare increase, whether there's been a rise or a drop? Because this is a very important factor in considering why some passengers would rather use illegal ride-hailing services. In fact, it's risky to do so, but why would they turn to these platforms? I think the demeanor of taxi drivers, the operation, etc., are all factors at play affecting patronage. We should resolve these problems instead of allowing incessant fare increases. At the same time, the government should consider why the government is always helpless in the face of the taxi trade. There is a good regulatory regime for other forms of public transport, but not the taxi trade. Whenever they are unable to solve the problems of the trade, they come and ask for fare increases. This is not the way out. I hope that if the transport department does not keep statistics in this regard, that they should start to do so. Now, the other point is that you can resolve the problem of overcharging if you make it mandatory for them to accept electronic payment. You're not doing that, and you're being too lax on them. It seems that they are above the law. This will tarnish the image of Hong Kong. Well, in Lan Kwai Fong, there is a team of police officers and district care team members to monitor the situation exactly because of the rampant problem of taxi overcharging. So we don't just have black sheep in the trade, it's a prevailing issue. I really find it hard to support the fare increase if you don't resolve these issues. Commissioner, let me share these figures with you. The member asked about ridership or patronage in the past few years. The daily patronage stood at about 700,000 trips. That's around 70% of the total patronage of public transport. However, as far as the taxi trade's income is concerned, patronage is not the only factor. The length of the journey and the number of trips are all factors at play. For example, after we resume normal travel, there may be more passengers traveling to the BCPs. So we do take into account these things when we assess the situation.
Dr. Loi-Kwok, thank you, Chairman. In the government's paper, there is a table showing the figures between 2019 and 2023. There is a comparison of the figures on the average monthly net income of rentee drivers, owner drivers, and renter owners. After netting off inflation, there is a slight increase of the net income of rentee drivers. For owner drivers, the net income drops by about 10%. I'm quite surprised by the drop of the incomes. This is because we have seen taxi fare increases before. For urban taxi renter owners, their net income drops from some $11,000 to some $6,000. I've heard complaints from owner drivers because of the repair costs and the high insurance premiums. There is another table in the paper showing the costs of taxi drivers. The operating cost is about $12,000 every month, and a few thousand dollars go to insurance premiums. How come there is a 60% increase of their costs? There must be a reason behind. Members of this council, as well as representatives of the insurance sector, have held meetings before to look into this. It looks like we're facing a lose-lose situation. So the government has to think of some ways to tackle this. The insurance companies are also facing a hard time. They're losing money too. How come so much money has gone to claims by taxi drivers? How come there are so many taxi accidents? What are the issues that we are facing? How can we change the lose-lose situation to a more healthy situation? Now, if we just look at the numbers, we are seeing a huge drop of net income of renter owners. With a high taxi fare increase, we're going to see criticism in our society as well. So how is the government going to deal with this? Administration, compared with 2019, the rental has increased by about 19%, but the insurance premiums has really increased by 60%. So we have been talking about how we can control the operating costs and operating expenses of taxi drivers, and the insurance sectors have also been looking at this. Our conclusion is that we have to ensure that there's a risk assessment on the taxi trade's part. The taxi trade has to maintain their financial viability. We'll continue to be in talks with the insurance sector. How can we roll out more measures on risk assessments to encourage the insurance sector to implement different premium levels so that a reasonable premium level can be imposed on, say, taxi fleets? Mr. Tony Chay, taxi is part of our public transport system. taxis provide and to point-to-point services, so it's very convenient. There are taxis in other places in the world as well, and they have been also looking into how they can enhance the taxi service quality. In the future, I hope the government can really help improve the taxi service quality. Now, taxi trades are proposing different levels of fare increase. Paragraph 4 of the paper mentions that the TD considers five key areas on approving the taxi fare increase applications. And one of the key areas is to ensure the financial viability of taxi operation. I believe it has to do with the revenue and return of the taxi trade. Say if you put money in the bank and you may get some return through the interest rate. So here I wonder if the administration can provide more information on the return and revenue of the taxi trade. Now, the paper also mentions that we saw a resumption of normal travel in 2023. And so figures collected during the COVID pandemic may not be very relevant. I would still like to have more figures for reference, though. You see that we may see an improvement. And I therefore would like some extra information from the administration on the statistics. Well, the figures and information we provide in our paper is from 2023. We collected the data from the chips of the taxi meter. So we collected data from 2023 on their revenue. We also looked at the insurance premiums and operating costs of taxi trade in 2023. If members would like to have a breakdown of the information, please let us know. On the point about financial viability, we compared statistics from 2019 and 2023. After the comparison, well, we look at the net income of rentee drivers, renter owners, and owner drivers to see if they manage to break even. Chairman, I understand that the administration made a comparison. Well, if you want to encourage taxi trade to make more investment, I want to see if there are other figures that show the return of such investments. There must be other investment items involved, right? Well, we're talking about a type of public transport service, so we only look at data related to the taxi trade. Some wonder whether the cost of taxi license would put pressure on taxi drivers as well, but this is not what we look at. How about the return from other types of public transport? We'll provide the relevant information after this meeting. Now, four other members have pressed the button to speak. Depending on how much time we have, I may ask you to shorten your questions. Mr. Chao Shu-chong.
Thank you, Chairman. Taxi is a type of public transport that serves the public. I think it's inevitable that we see an increase in taxi fare. I've looked at the previous rounds of fare increase. The last time was in July 2022, and the previous one was in 2017. The average increase of taxi fare in these two rounds of fare increase was about 2%. And The magnitude of increase, I think, was reasonable. Now, the fare increase proposed is up to 17%, and it is hardly acceptable, and I don't think members of the public would find this affordable either. I hope the government will continue to act as the gatekeeper here. Is this the right timing for us to see an increase in taxi fare? And also, should we see such a magnitude of increase? Also, according to the government's paper, the taxi trade is facing a difficult operating environment. Is a significant taxi fare increase a solution here? Say, a restaurant fails to sustain its business and it's losing money. I don't think the restaurant owner would just resort to increasing the price of his food. He will have to think about how to enhance the food quality. So I hope the government should think about how to lower the operating cost of the taxi trade, and also you have to combat malpractices like refusal to accept a hire. Administration will definitely continue to serve as the gatekeeper here. Members mentioned that there was an increase in taxi fare previously. Now, the taxi trade is proposing a level of taxi fare increase. So this is not necessarily the increase that we're going to approve. We have to look at the long-term operation situation of the trade. We have to ensure healthy development in the trade. So we have introduced a series of measures, including the taxi fleet regime. Starting from today, we're going to accept applications. We also wrote out some facilitation measures to provide taxi drivers with convenience and also to facilitate taxi drivers' investment. We have selected some 60 pickup and drop-off points. Also, in our smart fund, we have set aside a certain amount, and there is a cap of $10 million for the fund to subsidize taxi drivers to install safety devices and also for them to open up booking platforms. These are all going to help with the long-term healthy development of the trade. On malpractices like unscrupulous drivers, we are stepping up penalty. And in September this year, we are going to roll out the offense point system. On the offense point system, for those who have incurred a certain number of points, they will be asked to take compulsory courses, and we are engaging training schools to provide these courses now. Ms. Jovi Chen. Thank you, Chairman. The Taxi Association branch of the FTU has mentioned that a taxi fare increase would affect the business of the taxi trade. Now, the taxi trade is asking for a 17% increase. That's too expensive. Last time, the taxi trade asked for a taxi fare increase because it wanted to attract new blood to the industry, and also it needed capital to enhance the taxi service quality. However, we're yet to see results in these regards. The taxi service quality has yet to catch up with the taxi fare increase. As mentioned, there's some black sheep in the trade, and we're seeing a vicious cycle here. And we're seeing a shrinking taxi trade, and it forces passengers to opt for ride-hailing services online. Would the government impose certain requirements or conditions on trade companies to guarantee the income of taxi drivers? Also, would you put into resources to enhance the taxi service quality so that passengers would find it value for money? Now, the two items that we are going to talk about in this meeting is about fare increases. And both types of fare increase are going to impose burden on the public. I hope the government can really act as the gatekeeper here, and it would carefully consider whether it should approve the taxi fare increase applications. Thank you.
Commissioner, the member's comment is noted. We will, of course, strive to strike a balance and do our gatekeeping. As far as the data are concerned, I think that as per our discussion, is there room for the taxi owners to increase rent there and then upon fare increase? I think that the market will come, will exert its influence. According to experience, after a fare increase, owners would observe whether there is an actual increase in income before proposing a rent increase. We understand that in the trade, there are different needs of different practitioners, and we need to strike a balance. We will do our gatekeeping. No follow-up. Mr. Yim Kong. Thank you, Chairman. During economic downturn, any substantial increase in the fare of public transport would, of course, attract the public outcry, especially the taxi trade has proposed yet another increase of over 10%. Mainland tourists have this general feeling that taxi fares are quite expensive. By comparison, taxi fares in Hong Kong are four times more expensive than taxi fares in the mainland. Basically, you can go all the way to Shenzhen Bay with the same amount of fares. So about this application, I note that there is it's due to a surge in insurance premium. Another factor is LPG prices. According to some members, we should use more new energy taxis. My question is on whether there is a timetable for replacing existing taxis with new energy taxis, because this is already happening in the mainland. The second question is high insurance premiums. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok asked this question. Why insurance premiums have surged by 60%? Is it because of the large number of claims and the large claim amounts? Because this hinges on the safety of taxis. In previous meetings, we discussed taxis in Singapore and the mainland and Japan. In fact, there is an upper age limit for taxi drivers. That's respectively 35 to 60. In order to ensure safety of our taxi services, would you put in place some age limit? Say if you're above 80, you should not drive a taxi. Commissioner, about new energy vehicles, it is the government's general policy to adopt the wider use of new energy vehicles. I understand that the Environment and Ecology Bureau has a target to meet. There is a Green Transport Fund or New Energy Transport Fund, and last year we rolled out a dedicated scheme providing 100% loan guarantee for taxi drivers. So we do encourage the trade to switch to electric taxis. We understand their concern is that they need to find suitable models. I understand the EEB is now striving to look for suitable models with the manufacturers. On the other issue,
Well, for the taxi trade and the insurance sector, they both need to consider financial viability of the respective sectors. I learned from the insurance sector that insurance premiums increase because of the losses that they've incurred through underwriting taxi insurance business. We will talk to the insurance trade to see whether risk segregation measures can be put in place. Say, if there are certain regulations for taxis, and in order to lower the risk, whether it's possible to lower insurance premiums. Now, to take the other question, there is a prevailing manpower shortage for public transport sector. We also understand the public concerns. So about the age limit of commercial drivers, we are drawing up a bill to put in place a fitness check for them. Next is my turn. We understand the plight of the taxi trade. Despite a slight increase in fare income, they also operated with more expenses. So against this background, I think this fare application of up to 16% is, after all, quite high. If we allow only a slight increase in taxi fares on the condition that they improve taxi services, then this is acceptable. On the other hand, it's not right just to transfer the difficulties onto consumers. Now, the taxi trade, in fact, has agreed that the problem has to do with a surge in insurance premiums. We need to find out, for example, whether there is a problem of champerty leading to insurance premium increases. And we also need to act with precision. Both this council and the taxi trade would like to see the installation of cloud-based cameras in taxi compartments. So you should proceed with that as quickly as possible. This could help lower insurance premiums, because at another meeting, according to the insurance sector, they will consider lowering the insurance premiums if compartment cameras are installed. So, Commissioner, please respond to that. In fact, we've helped the taxi trade overcome operating difficulties. After the new cross-harbor toll plans, taxis can now cross the harbor at a concessionary fare toll of $25. In fact, because of the redistribution of traffic across the cross-harbor tunnels, traffic is now smooth. So as for other problems, will you consider helping the trade further? Commissioner, I fully agree that in order to promote healthy development of the trade, we cannot just allow fare increases. They should also work on improving the environment and provide better services. On cost control, there is room to further discuss with the insurance sector to lower the insurance premiums, which take up the largest proportion of the operating expenditure. And as I explained earlier, be it the taxi fleet regime or tackling the problem of black sheep in the trade, the two-tier penalty system that will commence operation soon, we will join hands with the police in taking enforcement action. Commissioner, I asked this specific question on conducting a study on cloud-based cameras in taxi compartments. Yes, we are conducting a study. We're comparing the experience of operation in different jurisdictions. We also need to consider the composition of our taxi trade. There are 9,000 taxi licenses. 70% of them are individual licensees, so we need to proceed with caution. And as I mentioned, we are looking at the practices in other jurisdictions and about data retrieval, we need to consider the scope because this would lead to privacy concerns. And for installing cameras, there may be a one-off subsidy for taxi drivers. But we also need to look into, for example, the trade's capability in maintaining the daily operation of the cameras. We still have some other members who would like to speak, but because of the time limit, I'll only give each member 2 minutes. Kenneth Lau, Edmund Wong, Stanley Lee, Lee Shun Kong, and Gary Zhang. Kenneth Lau is away, so Mr. Edmund Wong. I saw this clip circulating on the internet that taxis in Hong Kong are actually the cheapest. If Hong Kong people are unable to improve their income, it's difficult to ride a taxi. Well, in fact, according to figures, we are not the cheapest in the world. We're not the most expensive. We understand the reason for proposing a fare increase, but at the same time, they should improve services. Around the world, taxis accept electronic payment, including credit card payment, but we don't have we don't have many taxis taking e-payments. It's said that we ranked the 20th in terms of being a smart city, but if we only allow cash to pay for taxi fares, if we can't improve services in this regard, we can hardly call ourselves a smart city. So my question for the government is whether there are measures to promote a wider adoption of electronic payment in the trade. Commissioner, I understand some taxis in the trade accept electronic payments such as Alipay, WeChat, or Octopus. And when we introduce the taxi fleet regime, we will impose a licensing condition for the fleet to accept e-payment. As for full adoption of e-payment by 18,000 taxis in the trade, we need to consider the operating circumstances. We should start with the taxi fleets, and if the experience is positive, this should help promote a wider adoption in the trade. Yes, I hope that the taxi fleets can take the lead. I understand that 1/4 of all taxis in Hong Kong are equipped with an Octopus reader, according to statistics, but if you ride a taxi, you will find that this device is not available. Of all good intentions, I hope that you do more to promote e-payment. Mr. Kenneth Lau, still away. Mr. Stanley Lee, I declare that I'm a member of the Taxi Service Quality Council. I am a new member this year. This fare increase application far exceeds the rate of inflation. Is it because of a rise in operating costs against a drop in patronage? I'm thinking, on the other hand, whether fares should be lowered to make the taxi business more competitive, because they talked about a rise in operating costs due to rise in insurance premium, and this boils down to the practice of taxi drivers and the maintenance. You should work with the trade and come up with ways to ensure that insurance premiums won't go up because of how these taxis are used, because this is a vicious circle. If insurance premiums further increase, there will be pressure to further increase taxi fares. This is a problem we need to face in the long run. Taxis are expensive to many people. Many passengers would rather take the MTR instead. So would fare increase actually help the taxi trade? I wonder if you've thought about this alternative. Thank you, member, for your comment. In considering the fare increase application, we consider the various factors and we conduct the respective analysis. On insurance premiums, I agree that we should explore ways to help the trade. Say, if they use new taxis, would it help with management and maintenance? Maybe there is, well, this is an incentive for the sector to explore lowering the premiums. And we will continue to follow up on this suggestion with the insurance sector and the taxi trade.
Mr. Li Chenkeng, thank you, Chairman. Whether it is taxi drivers or taxi owners, they're facing a high living cost, which is much higher than that in other places in the world. However, should we see such a significant taxi fare increase, we have to think about it. Now, we have to think about who will benefit from the taxi fare increase. We have taxi drivers and we have taxi owners. Some taxis are getting very old. Taxi drivers and taxi owners are faced with maintenance costs, insurance premiums, etc. And they have been having a hard time to break even. They have to use their own savings to pay for the maintenance cost. Now, we have seen a number of rounds of taxi fare increase. And we are also seeing a continuous increase of operating costs in the taxi trade. Whether it is the bus drivers or staff working for the railway operator, they get various fringe benefits. However, taxi drivers, they don't enjoy the same kind of fringe benefits. I'm a member of the Committee on Taxi Service Quality. I understand that the government must support the taxi drivers' administration. I agree to what the member said. We will serve as the gatekeeper. I thank the member for the comments. We understand the connection between the taxi fare increase and the livelihood of taxi drivers. Mr. Gary Zhang, thank you, Chairman. For the taxi trade, we have taxi owners and taxi drivers. For those that hold taxi licenses, they can use the licenses as a kind of investment tool. They can generate return with the licenses. So I don't see why the government needs to ensure the earnings of taxi owners. However, taxi drivers, it's a different story. We have to consider the livelihood of taxi drivers. I've looked at statistics from the past few years. I see that there has been a steady increase of the net income of taxi drivers. The earnings of taxi drivers actually exceed that of working in other public transport modes. The net income of taxi drivers see an increase of about 14%, which is higher than other frontline workers of the public transport trade. And also, if we talk about a significant taxi fare increase, what problems will arise? The total income of taxi drivers will drop. Also, taxi license holders have already said that they will increase the taxi rental if the taxi fare increase applications are approved. So there will be an impact on taxi drivers if the government approves the applications. We have to look at the investors and the taxi drivers separately. Administration. Understood. when we consider the applications, we will definitely act as the gatekeeper. We'll look at the interests of taxi drivers and taxi owners. We care about whether there will be a stable supply of taxi services, so we will try to strike a balance here. Mr. Dominic Lee, we are overrunning on this item, so I'm afraid that I would not be able to allow you to speak on this item. So that's all for this item, and the applications will be submitted to the Exco for consideration as well. Please be reminded of that. Now we will talk about MTR fare adjustment for 2024. Let us invite the administration as well as representatives from the MTRC to join us. Members who would like to speak on this item, you may press the button now. According to Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedures, members, if you have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest in relation to this discussion item, please disclose the nature of such interest. Understand that there is a PowerPoint presentation. I will invite Ms. Ida Lee to walk us through the paper first, and that will be the PowerPoint presentation. Ms. Lee, please. Chairman, we are here with representatives of the MTRC to brief members on the results of the MTR fare adjustment for 2024. Since 2007, when there was a railway merger, there was an agreement that there should be a fare adjustment mechanism. The fare adjustment mechanism is open and transparent according to statistics released by the government. For instance, the FAM takes into account the nominal wage as well as the composite consumer price index, and we come up with the adjustment every round. Last year, we completed the review of the FAM. While we decided to retain the same formula, we have incorporated the productivity factor into the formula. Also, we are rolling out a series of promotions and concessions to passengers. According to the FAM formula, in 2024, the increase of MTR fare should be 3.2%. However, we are seeing a trigger of the affordability cap arrangement. That means the increase of fares should not exceed the MMHI, the median monthly household income. And therefore, after we've triggered the cap arrangement, we'll see an increase of 3.09%. And there will be a deferment of increase of 1.25%, which will be handled next year. This cap arrangement takes into account the affordability of passengers. On the other hand, the government is glad to see that the MTRC has earlier announced that it will continue to roll out a series of promotions and ongoing concessions, and that it will take into account the operating environment, social and economic conditions, to actively respond to the aspiration of passengers and cater to the needs of different passenger groups. Chairman, I will now invite Ms. Jenny Young, Manager Director of MTRC, to tell us about the fare adjustment of 2024. Then we will be listening to members' views on this. Ms. Young, please. Thank you, Chairman. As Ms. Ida Lee said just now, the FAM is an open and transparent system. Every year, we adopt a direct drive formula to determine the level of adjustment. It depends on the economic situation as well as our operating costs as we come up with the fare adjustment. As we saw the railway merger back in 2007, we have an autonomy of setting the fare adjustment. And there is a binding effect to the operating agreement, and we have to stick to the operating agreement as we come up with the fare adjustment based on the formula. In 2023, we completed the review of the formula, and we incorporated the linkage between our property development profit with the fare price. And in order to lower the burden on passengers, we introduced a one-off concession of 1.2%. We also gave back to passengers by introducing a half fare discount. There were views that because of the drop in property development profit, there is actually no actual decrease of our fare price. But last year, we saw at least 0.6% of the drop of fare price. And this is going to benefit the passengers. If we see an increase of our property development profit, then the decrease will go up from 0.6% to 0.8%. We believe this will take into account the affordability of passengers, and this will also ensure the financial viability of the MTRC. Now, this chart here shows the results of the mechanism after it's triggered. Starting from 2013, we see a drop of we see the subtraction of 0.6% in the fare adjustment. Without the subtraction back in 2007, it would follow the yellow dotted line here. Now, in 2013, because of the introduction of the 0.6% subtraction, now we see the black line here. We see a new adjustment level. And every time the adjustment is or the increase is lower than the inflation rate, if we followed the old system with the increasing operating cost, the it will affect the minus 0.6% adjustment. Therefore, we have introduced a new linkage between the property development profit and the fare adjustment. So when the property development profit goes up, there will be a higher drop of fare prices. You can also see here the change of operating cost, and you see that the operating cost has gone up by 5.3%. And this has to do with the electricity cost as well as the income of our workers. Now, this year, the fare adjustment has taken into account the affordability of passengers. We have we're triggering the affordability cap arrangement after taking into account the MMHI. Therefore, the increase would be 3.09%, and there will be a deferment of increase of 1.85% in 2025. We'll make sure that the adjustment would take into account the affordability of passengers. We've taken into account also the economic situation, and therefore we are going to continue to roll out different fare concessions, including city savers, the five types of monthly pass, Chun Moon Nam Chun Day pass, as well as the early bird discount. And people will continue to enjoy a 75% discount under the Chun Moon Nam Chun Day pass scheme. And there will also be a fare concession for those who take the light rail. Over half of the trips we offer discounts to passengers.
Apart from the monthly passes and other fare concessions in general, we have ongoing fare concessions benefiting the elderly and students. For the different groups altogether, we benefited 500 million passengers at an expense of $2.9 billion. Now, for the interchange discount with GMBs, this applies to elderly as well. So for elderly using minibus as well as MTR, they pay only $1.50. We help passengers save $60 million. We have six types of passes. We help passengers save up to 30% of their fares. Say if somebody travels from Tuen Mun Station via Tuen Ma Line to Kwun Tong Station, the original Octopus fare stands at $24.20, but with the monthly pass and early bird discount, this passenger pays only $15.50, so that's a 36% concession. The other example is somebody traveling from Tung Chung to Hong Kong Station. Using the monthly pass, he saves up to 45% of the fares. Next, I'd like to turn to asset rehabilitation, repair and maintenance. We have continued to increase the commitment. This is a big commitment. In 2023, as just announced, we are putting in $13.6 billion or $1.36 billion. So as we put in our resources to revamp our assets, we are making a lot of effort because the system has been running for more than 40 years. We need to put in more resources to maintain our assets. At the same time, we have procured new trains and they are commencing operation gradually. We're also spending on promoting new energy and renewing our assets and ensuring high quality operation of our train service. At the same time, we put in resources to keep up with the times and upgrade the facilities at the stations. For example, we've been revamping the escalators and using speedier lifts, upgrading the air conditioning systems so that ventilation improves. We also have smart toilets, nursery, baby care rooms, as well as other facilities. Jenny, why don't you speed up because we are running out of time. Right, perhaps I will skip the next few slides. At the previous meeting last Friday, we reported to members our new facilities and our community outreach programs. We work with our stakeholders to promote social development in Hong Kong. Now back to the FAM. This mechanism help strike a balance between views of different stakeholders, and we are also able to balance the books whilst ensuring safe, quality, reliable services for the public. Let me read out the names of members who will be asking questions. Michael Look, Gary Zhang, Lau Men Kong, Kim Yim Kong, Michael Tian, Dominic Lee, Jovi Chen, and myself. 4 minutes for each member questions and answers. Please, Mr. Michael Look. We are discussing fare increase proposals one after another today. I don't think the public will be happy about this. Now, say the MTR is something that almost every citizen uses. In fact, I came in by MTR this morning. Under the FAM, there is an affordability cap that is the year-on-year change in the median monthly household income. So the mechanism has taken into account the affordability of the public. I just want to say that on the basis of this fair adjustment, the MTR should strive to provide more concessions. Say for monthly passes, it covers Tuen Ma Line, Tung Shung Line, and Tuen Mun Line. For other railway lines, they are covered only by city savers. The city saver, it is not flexible. I hope you'll develop more monthly passes for different lines. For the deferred increase, the cumulative figure is now 1.85%. The public are of the view that you cannot continue to carry forward the adjustment rate indefinitely. At most, it should stop at just a two-year period. At the lapse of the two-year period, you should just scrap the proposed increase. Now, the FTU is concerned about workers' rights. You have so many projects to upgrade and revamp facilities. In fact, I went on a visit of your facility about the smart inspection system. You should, however, retain the veteran inspectors. They are the masters. They can detect problems and flaws with their vast experience. So there should be ways to retain them. There must be ways to help keep the newcomers so that they stay for 5-10 years for them to accumulate experience and become masters. Wages is one factor, but it's not all. Of course, everyone wants a pay increase. Instead of putting in place something like the master pay scale for civil servants, you should at least put in an increment scale so that for those veterans and seasoned staff, there should be an increment scale to keep them for the benefit of your company's development. Because if you provide good service, the public will accept the fare increase. Thank you. The members' comments noted. We'll consider these suggestions. The member also mentioned our staff. Many of our staff are dedicated. We regularly review the remuneration package and other benefits for them. Right. What about the monthly passes and other concessions? Any new ones? We need to conduct studies. In fact, the monthly passes cover the whole network, in our view. But we will continue to consider how we can provide more one-off concessions for our passengers. Next, Mr. Gary Zhang. Thank you, Chairman. At the time we reviewed the fare adjustment mechanism, there were a number of concerns because the MTR maximized its profits and raised fares substantially despite the drop in service quality. Now, last year there was a review. With new arrangements put in place, adjustments were made to the fare adjustment mechanism. Now we can have a true picture of the direct drive FAM formula. What is it like? In fact, I've prepared this chart. Well, the proposed adjustment is 3.09%. Comparing to the mechanism before review, the adjustment would be just the same, 3.09%. But then since the FAM would be pegged to the Hong Kong property development profit of the MTRCL, and there has been a drop in income in this regard. So under the new formula, upon review, there is no fare concession, whereas previously we would stand to gain $300 million in terms of fare concessions. if we're unable to trigger the conditions that we first imposed, such that the outcome is now faring worse than what we've expected, then is the FAM effective? I do have reservations. A major review should be conducted once every 5 years. And in fact, in the past, we have had interim reviews before. Time is right for an interim review to be conducted because passengers don't get as much benefit as the mechanism before review. As for the property profit of MTRCL, I don't think they would able to get up to $5 billion of profit. So in the coming years, with a gloomy market outlook, it would be impossible to trigger this factor. Well, I think the managing director already explained that the fare revenue would very much impact on the performance of the MTR. So fares aside, I think we should review the mechanism itself. For example, if you're able to get a profit of $8 billion this year, and when you're sitting on huge wealth, you should show some commitment by shouldering some of the or absorbing some of the fare increase. Say, taking the productivity factor aside, so and so forth, the number should be 3.8%. The MTR should shoulder some of the fare adjustment. If the MTR is earning, say, $10 billion, then it should show a bigger commitment. The fact is, the FAM is not doing justice to the public. I find it very hard to support your mechanism wholeheartedly. Well, last year, the review was conducted and that the formula was changed. Be it 0.6 or 0.7% productivity factor, this helped drive down fares. In fact, it's a multiplier effect in proposing this change. It will be amplified more than a dozen times. So we need to consider our fiscal position as well as operating circumstances. The outcome of the FAM is such, but next year we'll take into account the other factors. And apart from cash flow, we also need to consider other streams of revenue that have yet to be entered into the accounts under the Hong Kong Property Development Profit account. Mr. Lam and Kwong, I agree, first of all, with the efforts in community support. They have volunteers visiting the community together with our colleagues, and we must acknowledge their efforts in showing care for the community. And yet, all these efforts are no way to address the so-called grievances among the public because of the fare increase. Well, at least there is not so much grievance, but some sort of sentiment against fare increase. Members discussed fare adjustment as well as the MTRCL's profit and how this should be linked. At the moment, there is a link to the Hong Kong Property Development Profit of the MTRCL. I'm suggesting that this be pegged to the overall profit of the MTRCL, not just property profit. About the proposed increase carried forward, there is a negative perception. Despite having the affordability cap, the adjustment rate will sooner increase would sooner or later be imposed. Or of course, the adjustment would need to be carried forward because of some external factors. But by the time, if you're able to introduce increase, there would be a major public outcry. So you should impose a cap and make sure that this is in line with public sentiment. Finally, I acknowledge the effort of the MTRCL in upgrading the facilities in MTR stations. Say for Meifu Station, lifts are being installed and the public are craning the necks for their commissioning. For some facilities, you should modernize them. Say for exit E of Nam Chang Station, this is an empty space. Of course, you don't need as many lifts and escalators because in the past there was just the Changsha Wan wholesale market. Now, this place will come with schools, private residential estates, public housing estates. So circumstances have changed. You have built one one-way escalator that goes up, but with the change in the environment, you are not meeting the public's expectations, so you should heed the views and improve the facilities.
Ms. Young, we've heard our members' views and we'll follow up on the situation at Nam Chuan Station. Thank you. Mr. Yim Kong, thank you, Chairman. According to open figures, the MTRC is earning a profit for 3 years in a row. Last year, the recurrent profit reached up to $4.3 billion. And so we are seeing that the cap arrangement is being triggered this time. Will the MTRC consider scrapping the 1.85% of accumulated fare increase as well as the 2.11% of the 0.11% that will be carried forward? We are seeing an increase of 3.09% of fare price. Will you roll out more concessions? And will you increase the amount of discounts rolled out under the Fare Saver scheme? Thank you. Ms. Young, a number of members mentioned about the deferred increase, and we will definitely stick to the median monthly household income cap. If the affordability cap arrangement is triggered, then we'll definitely not increase the fare that exceeds the level. In order to maintain high quality service, well, we are faced with a number of challenges. On the Fare Saver scheme, I will ask Ms. Diane Chu to tell you how we're going to improve the scheme. On Fare Savers, the purpose of setting up this scheme is to enhance the pool of passengers. This is a commercial arrangement. Back in 2002, we rolled out the Fare Saver scheme. It is set up at the new railway lines as well as entry and exits at different MTR stations. With an expansion of our railway network, we are seeing a change in our Fare Saver scheme, and therefore we are rolling out different one-off concessions as well as different fare promotions. Last year alone, we saw $2.9 billion of discounts to passengers, and over half of the trips that we provided, people are enjoying a discount. And we're seeing a change in people's traveling pattern as well. And last year, we also rolled out the interchange discount with GMB, and the discount increased from 30 cents to 50 cents, and the discount amounted to some $16 million, which benefited 400,000 passengers. Any follow-up questions? All right, Mr. Michael Tian. Thank you, Chairman. If all kinds of public transport increase the fare prices based on the inflation rate, we'll definitely give our support, our party, the round table. But if you are only following the median monthly household income as you adjust your fare price, of course, it would cause public outcry since 2008 when the FAM was rolled out. The inflation rate was about 2.6% every year, and the wage increase was about 3.7% every year. And the fare increase on average is 2.27%, which is lower than inflation rate. Since the implementation of the affordability cap, only 2013, as well as there were only 2 years where we saw the affordability cap arrangement being triggered. During the review of the fare adjustment mechanism, I asked that the fare adjustment should be linked with the profits made by MTRC, and last year we only saw $2 billion of property development profit by the MTRC, but the total profits made by the MTRC was $7 billion. Well, the Financial Secretary is also forecasting a drop in revenue of the government in terms of from land premium. So the economy is sluggish, and you're seeing an expansion of your railway network. You've been receiving rental income. You're also getting income from advertisements. So there's no reason for you to just link your property development profit with the productivity factor. Also, I think the subtraction in the formula was unreasonable. So for $7.6 to $10 billion of profits, you only subtract 0.8% from your formula. So for every $2.5 billion, you subtract 1 percentage point. Or 0.1 percentage point in the in the fare adjustment. Unless you can grow the pie, you should not increase the fare price so significantly. Well, I support the fare adjustment mechanism. However, you failed to carry out maintenance during night time, and I asked you to carry out maintenance works or inspection once every 2 weeks, but you or once every week, and you said that you failed to do it. You rejected my request to carry out inspection once every week. And you only found out that there were cracks on the tracks when the train was running. This is unacceptable. Please tell me whether you are willing to carry out inspection work once every week, Ms. Yang. On the inspection of train tracks, we have to learn from the incidents that took place. On the frequency of the inspection to be carried out, we cannot make a promise here, but we'll definitely take stock of the experience we learned. Mr. Michael Tina, I'm afraid you won't have time to ask follow-up questions. MTRC, please respond to Mr. Tien's questions in another occasion. Mr. Dominic Lee. Well, we're seeing a very difficult economic situation and environment now. I think, however, an increase of 3.09% in MTR fare is unacceptable to most people in Hong Kong. I think there is a lot of room for you to improve the fare adjustment mechanism. Apart from the $2 elderly concession, are there other concessions for, say, students to give back to passengers? Ms. Yang, I thank Mr. Lee for the question on fare concession for the elderly. Apart from the $2 discount, we have been offering a half-price discount to elderly persons aged 65 or above. Even with the new $2 discount scheme, we are still promoting the half-fare concessions. On other concessions schemes, as mentioned, we're rolling out the interchange discount with GMB. Apart from $2 discount, the elderly passengers are enjoying the $0.5 discount under the interchange discount scheme. For buses that connect, feeder bus that connects with the light rail, it's free. Apart from offering discounts, we've done a lot of work. For instance, we are increasing the number of chairs. We are adding handrails to our facilities. We are lowering the speed of escalators, for instance. We're also adding different signages at the stations for elderly people, because elderly people may forget which station they're at. We are also offering different facilities, including app for elderly people. The MTRC is the only public transport operator that offer half price to students. Also, last year, we digitalized the entire application procedure for the student travel scheme, so students will no longer have to fill out forms to enjoy the half fare concessions. These are all works that we have done. I have a follow-up question. Yes. I have got some feedback. You roll out discounts to full-time students, but for students about the age of 25, they won't be able to enjoy the half-fare concessions. What is the rationale behind it? Well, we think that there should be a cutoff point. We believe that most students finish their 12-year basic education by the time they reach 25. They should be able to complete their, for instance, master degree education when they reach 25. Ms. Jovi Chen, I think the MTRC should thank the taxi trade, because in the last discussion item, we talked about a 17% proposed increase on taxi fares. I think MTR fare increase deals an even heavier blow to the public. Mr. Michael Luke mentioned about the impact on the public, so I won't repeat it here. There have been frequent traffic incidents between Tsuen Wan Station and Tsim Sha Tsui Station. We saw a crack on train tracks, and we've seen a drop of service quality of the MTRC. I want the MTRC to tell us how they're going to improve its service quality with the fare increase. The MTRC constantly talks about the concessions it rolls out. I understand that back in 2014, there was a concession scheme that encouraged passengers to commute during peak hours. And this February, the MTRC lowered the discount from 65% to 75%. Are there statistics showing that how much you are saving with the lowering of the discount?
I'll extend the meeting by 5 minutes. Jenny, let me respond to the point about repair and maintenance. Since a member mentioned an incident, we are concerned about each and every incident. One incident is too many for us, so we do our utmost to take preventive measures. We make sure that sufficient resources are given to our maintenance teams. Apart from repair and maintenance, after each incident has happened, we evaluate that and we find out the reason behind the happening of the incident. We also review our practices to ensure that this incident will not be repeated. We continue to maintain and revamp our assets to ensure a high level of service. In fact, in recent years, we have been deploying state-of-the-art technology to monitor our assets so that a preemptive approach can be taken to predict the happening of incidents. In fact, underneath the train cars, we install devices to detect the vibrations of tracks. We also monitor the overhead lines so that any change in temperature or other parameters will be detected that will draw our attention to the status of our assets. In fact, last year, we achieved a 99.9% operating accuracy. But of course, in April alone, we understood that the number of incidents have happened, and we do attach importance to these matters. Diane will answer your question on early bird discount. The early bird discount was introduced in 2014 as a pilot. We wanted to encourage some passengers to start the journeys earlier for greater comfort. Post-COVID, there's been a major change in the commuting pattern of passengers. We will carefully consider the commuting patterns and the economic circumstances and roll out different schemes to benefit the passengers. Let me supplement this answer. When we changed the fare discount from 35% to 25%, we noticed that the commuting pattern remains the same. In fact, recently, as we adjusted the discount from 35% to 25%, again, we did not detect a change in commuting pattern. That means we can continue to encourage passengers to start their journeys earlier for greater comforts and smoother operation. I'm asking about the concessionary amount reduced. I can give you this number afterwards. I think we'll have to adjourn this meeting at 12:55. I'm the last one to speak. The affordability cap hasn't been triggered for years, and some say that this is not useful. But I say that the affordability cap has, after all, been effective. Otherwise, the fare increases would have been much more substantial. Like Mr. Michael Look said, over the years, for the adjustment rate carried forward, we'd like the government to work on that, to say at the lapse of the two-year period, the increase carried forward should be scrapped so that we won't be having any outstanding payments for the MTRCL. For the city savers and monthly passes, please make sure that you won't increase the fares as well, because these fare concessions benefit the grassroots passengers. So in the next fare adjustment exercise, please don't increase the fares for these two promotions.
fair concessions are important. On this occasion, the MTR proposes a fare increase without proposing new fare promotions. There should be, say, one trip free for every 10 trips and other forms of concessions. And Jenny just now mentioned that the FAM formula contains an element that pegged the increase to the level of profit from property development, ranging from 0.6% to 0.8%. Like Michael Tian said, there should be a higher proportion. It should not be limited to 0.8%. Say in the coming years, you may be able to make a bigger profit from property development. And yet, with a productivity factor capped at 0.8%, you will not be able to offset the increase. So this link should be improved to properly reflect the extent of profit you earn from property development. This should be incorporated in the future FAM formula. Whilst we are keen to promote healthy development of your corporation, please make sure that there won't be fare increase year after year, because this has a negative, this will cause a negative image on your part. Right, your comments are noted about the increase carried forward and the calculation of our income. We will take all these into account in our next review exercise. Fare concessions as well? Yes, we'll consider rolling out new fare promotions. That concludes today's meeting. There being no other business, meetings adjourned.